Well, I was hoping by now to get outside and do some Land Rover jobs, but the weather's still very up and down and we're not quite there yet, so I'm carrying on with the Felix project. Happily, the damaged crankcase has come back from EMP laser welding, or EMP tooling, you'll find them under either name. There's quite a thick coat of paint on this crankcase, and it wasn't actually until I stripped off all the paint that the full extent of the damage was quite obvious. I probably wouldn't have bought it if I'd realised. This here is an old repair, which was deemed strong enough and left alone. But this lug here was nearly cracked right away, and there were a load of cracks in this area, and three that emanate from this boss. The beauty of laser welding is it doesn't put too much heat in. In this casting, you've got, in these bearing housings, two white metal bearings cast in, and obviously the white metal has a very low melting point. So ordinary welding methods were not really going to be suitable for repairing this, which with cast iron repair usually involves the item being heated up. So anyway, they've done a really nice job. One thing that can be problematic is re-threading a boss like that once it's got some weld in there. You will struggle just to put an ordinary tap through it, and that can actually do more damage. Again, one of the great things about laser welding is its accuracy, and they've just gone up to the edge, as I asked, but not broken into the thread. For what that is, that won't matter. The main thing is they've tackled all the sort of structural repairs, and that should now be quite strong. So, really impressed with that service. It's not a cheap fix all, but it's a lot cheaper than having castings made, pattern work and so on, and you know, a mere fraction of that. And it's saved what would otherwise have become a stalled project. And I'm hoping that that technology will at some point save that little Stuart Turner as well. So inside you can see the old repair, which is quite ugly, but then you can see the new recent repair, the laser welds. All in all, quite a nice job. And you can just see there the back of one of the cast-in bearings, so really quite close to the area to be repaired. Also, another little repair here, there was a big crack through this corner, and they've done that. So, that's now ready for a coat of paint. Well, there's the first coat of paint on the Felix engine crankcase, just so you can see what it's going to look like. I'll do a second coat this evening, and then probably leave it a few weeks to harden up. The bits that I've already painted, I did that just after Christmas, I think it was, and we're now in approaching mid-March. That's just gone hard enough that it doesn't feel tacky to the touch anymore like fresh paint does. So that paint is going to be okay now to rub down and get some more coats on. So this likewise is probably going to have to sit for some time, but now the weather's warmed up, it's getting a lot easier to paint things, so it won't take quite so long. Because it was media blasted, it's been painted inside and out. Just red oxide primer. If it was anything else, I'd be using a proper crankcase sealer, but for a little stationary engine, I'm not too worried about that. But better to seal the castings with something than not at all. Despite having cleaned it out very well, there's always a risk of a little bit of blast media being left, so this way is better. The main reason for blasting the castings was just to give the paint a really good key, and because I don't want any rust coming back through, it will stay nice for a long time like this. One thing that occurred to me is that this engine is really quite unusual, having the horizontal split crankcase. Single cylinder engines with split crankcases are more usually vertical. The Jap engines, Jap motorcycle engines, are quite a good example. And I set to look through a load of books about engines sort of through the 1900s, 1910s, and it seems that by 1920 the split crankcase had pretty much died out in terms of the horizontal split. Found quite a few big multi-cylinder engines, even a six-cylinder tri-block side valve engine with a horizontal split crankcase, but they weren't advertised after 1920, and certainly single cylinders are very unusual. So you'd think this would be really well located, but all the bolts that fit these holes are actually a fairly sloppy fit, so I guess they just bolted it up and tightened it all up where it all rotated nicely. It's a bit crude really. Well, I think this will be it for the video in this update. I've now just finished painting all the parts of the Felix engine over the last weekend. It's taken some time, mainly because the first coat was applied during the depths of winter, and it took an age to dry, even when I brought it into the house, once the paint had started to harden off. So they've all these parts have had an etch primer, then several coats, two or three I think it was, of red oxide to build it up a bit, which I then rubbed back, and then applied three coats of this lovely Craftmaster engine enamel, which has got a really deep shine to it. I think it's the best finish I've achieved on an engine yet, so I'm really pleased with it. And I'll just let it harden right off and then probably give it all a really good polish, which will just help protect it a bit. There's plenty of tidying up to do where things have been demasked. You get a build up of paint around the edges, but once we've done all that and it's hardened off a bit, we get on and lap the valves in, that sort of thing. The reason for the glossy finish is that normally I would use this sort of brush. It's quite nice fine bristles, but I find even that usually leaves brush marks. But this casting particularly has some fairly complicated shapes like this here. So I cut down one of these artist brushes, which I think are natural horsehair or something like that, but it's very fine, whatever it is. And I found that it left an absolutely beautiful finish, so I just stuck with it and continued painting all the parts with this tiny little brush. So in the future I shall try and find some like this that are like an inch wide perhaps. But it was worth sticking with because the finish is nice. And it prolonged what I find quite a pleasurable job. I actually do really enjoy painting. Very satisfying part of the job. Anyway, so that's it. I'm going to throw a load of photographs in, and you can have a look at that magneto. But hopefully the next time you see it, I'll be building up the bottom end of the engine on a little assembly stand. That's my next job. While we're on the subject of stationary engines, I spotted this for sale locally. It was so close I could have pushed it home if it was on wheels. But it's a nice original condition 1939 Lister Junior. This will be my next engine project. Lots of original paint, so plenty of scope for a nice oily rag restoration, as they call it. But it'll all be done with boiled linseed oil, properly preserved and mechanically restored. So something to look out for in the future. Anyway, here's a load of photos for you so you can see how that magneto got restored. we've suddenly arrived at the more interesting part of the Felix restoration. We can actually start putting a few things together. As I previously mentioned, the horizontal split crankcase is somewhat unusual, and it doesn't seem to make a lot of sense to modern eyes perhaps. But back in 1910-1911, the high speed combustion engine was still a relatively new bit of technology, and they were still messing about trying all sorts of different things to see what worked best. Vertical split crankcases are reasonably common. I worked on a few of those, and they very often have long bolts or studs that go right through the crankcase halves and pull it all together, and they've very often got a gasket between the two. And when you think about the way the forces are moving through the crankcase, it's probably quite acceptable. But to me, having a gasket between the two halves of a horizontal split crankcase, it just doesn't seem like a good idea. And so it was with this engine. When I took it apart, there were two gaskets in there on either side, one stuck to each half of the crankcase. And having done a trial assembly with the crank in there, you can see that the top crankcase half is rocking on the crank. So it required those shims to gain running clearance. And sure enough, if you just nip these screws down, pulling the two halves together, it all locks up. So we need to look at that today. And I went away and thought about it. One option was to get the bearing scraper out, scrape the bearings to bring these two halves close together and then achieve the correct running clearance. We can do that. But having thought about it, of course, it's very easy to take the metal off, not easy to put it back on. So that's the route we're going to go. We're going to put some paper gaskets back in. It should probably be fine, but I'll just have to keep an eye on it. If the crankcase half bolts start working loose, then we might have to go back to the drawing board on that one. I do wonder if having gaskets in there contributed to some of this cracking that went on, but maybe I'm just overthinking it. I mean, sometimes with these early engines you need to throw away what you think you know and just try it, because that's what they were doing back then. Having done a bit of research into the people that were involved in building these engines, there are some quite interesting connections to the early days of motor racing and aviation. So it wasn't an engine just built by country blacksmiths. It was built by people who were at the cutting edge of technology at the time. So yeah, quite interesting. But my point being, they tried all kinds of things, and perhaps I shouldn't overthink it. So we're going to try and make some gaskets in there. Let's see how we get on. Let's just have a quick look inside. The crank's really quite a nicely made thing. We've got end float control at the back end, so you've got this bronze thrust washer there, and then this crank web is effectively a thrust face as well. Nice long bearing at the front, oil return scroll, the oil returns via a channel underneath. Same at the rear, only of course there's a bit of oil getting to this gear as well, which is flicked up into the timing case. And you've got these oil troughs, which are quite a generous size for the main bearings. And none of it's really worn out, it's in very nice condition, so it's got to say something for it. Nice big counterweights, bolt-on counterweights, all beautifully machined. Yeah, it's really a very nice thing for a stationary engine of this age. Well, I've got some sheets of cling seal, so I thought I'd just try that, as it's quite a good material for this kind of thing. But what I've got's way too thick. So I did actually measure this gap yesterday. What I did was I tightened all these screws down just enough to achieve a uniform gap all the way around, and it was 7 to 8 thou all the way around. So gasket material about 12 thou thick, allowing for it to compress slightly, is probably going to be about ideal. So unfortunately this is too much, this is about 20, and it's not going to crush down quite enough. So, see what else we've got. Now, fortunately, a few days ago I ordered a pack of flexoid paper of different thicknesses, so we'll definitely be needing that. Got some 14 thou paper in there now, and it's pinched up everywhere. I've just nipped these screws up, I haven't tightened them. Yeah, it's pretty good. These casting halves are as flat as you could expect them to be after the repairs they've had over the years. But you can hear there's still a fair bit of clearance there. Probably about 8th hour running clearance, something like that, which is a bit much really. So this is a 10th hour paper. I'm going to cut some strips of that and do the same experiment. We're getting closer. So the paper in there now is actually 9th hour thick, and the engine revolves, the crank revolves freely with in float, as you can hear, but there's no perceivable side play there, so I think the clearance is probably just a little small. So when my gasket pack arrives, if there's something around 10, 11 thou thick, we'll try that. And if that's generating too great a clearance, then we'll go with the thin stuff, about 9 thou, and scrape to the final clearance, which should achieve a nice result. But that's as far as we can go with that for now. So I think we'll turn our attention to the cylinder, that's the valves to lap in, have a look at the piston rings and so on. So here we have the cylinder casting. It's a blind cylinder, so no detachable head, side valve, and access plugs to remove the valves. Very typical of the time. The bore is extremely good. I don't think it's ever been reboard. I believe one of the identifiers of the European made engines and the English ones is the bore size. The Electra, sold by Hillman, it lists in the manual for that, or the catalogue rather, that I've got, that it's got a 90mm bore. This one is 95. Just very good piston clearance, it feels fine. The rings look good in the bore, so more than happy with that. The piston's in lovely condition, no problems there. The gudgeon pin has a little wear, but it's not bad enough to warrant replacing it, I don't think. And it's got a large bearing at the small end. Quite a nicely made thing with a keyway, and then it's got a pin on the other side to retain it as well. The valves, very long stems, they haven't worn out, and the guides are just cast into the block, and they're still perfectly serviceable. I think the valves all lap in very nicely. All the parts have the engine number on, 506. Interestingly, the piston bears number 507, so I think there was a bit of a cock-up at the factory there. These are the cam followers. They've got a ball bearing in one end, the other end is hardened. They just sit in these drillings in the cylinder. A little bit of wear in those, but we're not worried about that. And then there's a little crankcase breather there as well. First thing I'm going to do though is make up the cylinder base gasket. Hopefully you can see there, the cylinder bore is pretty good, and I've honed it very lightly. And there is the piston bearing number 507. Interesting, it's got two rings per groove. I can't believe that it would ever have had just two rings that thickness. I had a First World War era Douglas engine, big flat twin water cooled, called a rear engine. You go back a few videos and you'll find that. I've never seen another, but that had very similar pistons. Exactly the same sort of rings, and no oil scraper, just like this. Oil scraper rings weren't really a thing back in those days, so it'll probably puff a bit of blue smoke. And you can see there the pin that locks the gudgeon pin on this side. on the other side the keyway. Quite unusual. It's a nice casting, it's actually quite a thin wall, with the piston skirt machined as thin as possible. And a slight dome on the crown. There's a cylinder base gasket made, just flexoid paper, nothing spectacular. And now we're just going to have a look at the valve seats. So hopefully you can see there that they're in quite a good condition, they don't need recutting. I'm just going to get some grinding paste and lap the valves. Very rarely is it that simple. As you can see, the valve seats are in generally quite good condition. You can see that the seats are somewhat crudely cut in the block, and if this were anything other than a very simple stationary engine, I'd probably be just turning a little bit off the, or grinding a little bit off if I had the machine, off the outside of the valve there, just to reduce the seat area a bit before lapping it in. Likewise, you've got this massive taper here. If it was anything slightly more high performance, it would probably pay to lose a bit of that. But anyway, for what it is, that's a bit academic really. So we'll just see how it laps in. I think I will start with coarse paste and then work to fine as usual. And for comparison, the valves lapped in. So we'll get on and put them in the cylinder and fit the springs. That's about as far as I can go with the cylinder on the Felix engine for now. The carburetor's fitted, just made a gasket for that. Kind of nice when you start seeing what it's all going to look like. Tighten things like the valve bungs up as much as I can. Once it's all bolted together properly, I'll nip them up for the first run. Got the top wall's connection in, had to make a little seal for that. Various fibre washers I've made, they were slightly odd sizes. I'll just turn it around and you can see the other side, but the valves are in. Nice strong valve springs still, probably the originals, but perfectly serviceable. The decompressed tap's a nice thing, that is an original fitment to the engine. Needed a little bit of repair, it had a split in it, so I just soldered it up. This is for use as a priming tap. I've no idea whether we'll actually need that with this engine. I'm going to have the cooling tank on this side, so I've set the angle of the top connection just to have a pipe that sweeps around it. I've got a cooling tank, so I'll show you that shortly. So this is the cooling tank that I've got for the engine. It was an eBay purchase, all of about 15 quid, and it's an ex-Startomatic diesel engine Lister fuel tank. So it's a diesel tank. It was complete, painted, all the fittings when I got it, just a little bit battered, and I've gradually been straightening it out, removing the unnecessary bits, the float level indicator, the data plate and so on, and starting to patch up the holes. But it's already got this fitting here, which is ideal for the bottom connection. The bottom of the tank slopes towards the drain point, so that's ideal. Might plug that up at some point. And it's got this nice anti-splash top in there, which would be ideal. So a few more dents to knock out of it, but we're nearly there. It's going to need a decent stand. And I'm going to get a fuel tank made, which will actually follow the shape of the tank, sort of fit about there. It looks about right, it's about the right size. I didn't want to use an old oil drum or something like that, it just doesn't look right. So this is a nice old piece that will go with the engine quite well. Anyway, there you are. So I hope you've enjoyed the update on the engine. And next time we'll look at it, hopefully we'll get the crankshaft clearance sorted out. Carry on putting it together. Thanks very much for watching.